lunch or watch him work? No? Everybody, we all know how to do this? Yeah? We're going to work some? Anybody out there
in the Twitter universe? We're going to work some for 20 minutes, and then we're going to talk about your work and your creative process. Emphasis on your. Yeah? And if you're out there and you want to tweet in or however.
Yeah.
Did you grow your hair?
I did. It's
like today. A lot over the past like 2 weeks.
Yeah, it's had a moment.
Spring. It grew. It's like,
yeah. So if you are watching at home and you want to ask some questions, you can tweet at us at WatchMeWorkSLP with the hashtag HowlRound, which is HOWLROUND. Or there's actually on the HowlRound.tv streaming platform, there's actually a little questions thing that you can click on and comment in, and I'll be looking at that as well.
All right.
Yeah, I think that's it.
Awesome. You want to do my work for me today?
Yes!
I know, right? It's all great. I think you get more work than that.
Yes.
All right, so we're gonna do 20 minutes. Ready?
Yep.
Thank you.
Did anybody get any work done? Like one word.
Did you get one thing done?
Right. So here's the part of the show where we ask you how you're doing and, you know, if there's any way I can give you some feedback on your creative process. I'd be happy to. That's why I'm here. Anybody?
Yes.
So
remind me of your name.
Oh, I'm Alexa.
Alexa.
Nice to see you. I am currently writing play. I'm working on my own play right now.
Okay.
But I'm working on this for a contest that I'm going to participate in.
Okay.
And basically, to make it short, my question is: sometimes, personally, I find it hard to work on my own stuff because I don't really have a deadline right now because I'm not writing it, quote unquote, for anybody.
Right.
So sometimes I don't work on that as much as I think I should. So sometimes I do like little contests or little things with deadlines to help me get into that mindset. But sometimes I also feel that I spend too much time on these little contest plays that I care, I guess you would say, less about in a way.
Oh.
So basically what I'm asking is, do you think I should keep trying to train myself to do a deadline by doing these contest plays that I care a little bit less about, or should I just find a way to regiment myself so the play that I do care about, I get done, or I get more done?
Right.
You know,
did everybody hear her question answered? Right. What's really good, you can pat yourself on the back for several things. Really good is to realize, I work better when I have a deadline. So I'm going to go for these contests because they have deadlines. So you're sort of noticing what you need and you're going after what you need. Okay. And the question is, should you keep doing plays you don't care about because you submit them to contests for you? But what do you think of that?
I'm kind of leaning towards that. Well, see, I can't not care about what I'm working on. That's just not how I function. So I guess it's more of a, technically speaking, I care less about them. But it's also kind of good because I feel like there's less pressure when I write these, so I have more fun doing that.
Right.
So maybe my question is, how do I take the pressure off myself of, you know,
It's tricky because what you're saying is, to have a deadline, it gives you a certain kind of pressure, which makes you run to the deadline. But because you choose to work on plays that you don't care as much about, it takes some of the pressure off. So that's another thing you need. You need to have a little less pressure or a little more fun. Right? So, yeah, I would say, you know, work on stuff that really matters, right? So if it's your place that you're not submitting to these little contests, as you call them, then just go ahead and find a way to work on the stuff that really matters to you. Now, how can you have a deadline for something that you're just writing for yourself, right?
Yeah.
You can just make one up.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, it's easy. So, you know, like, oh, I want a deadline, August the 1st. That's a good one. Right? Right? Or August the 1st. I'm just pulling it out of thin air. But I bet that's a really good deadline because it's far enough in the future to give you some time, you know, right? Because it's not like tomorrow, you know, right? That would make everybody freak out. But it's far enough in the future. But it's not so far. It's not like a year from now, which is so long in the future that you're going to forget, right? Okay, so you can make yourself deadlines like that. Or you can, if August the 1st isn't working, you can make July the 10th, but you know, whatever. Okay, so you can do that. You can do that for yourself. I do it all the time. Okay? The second thing is, how can you have more fun working on things that matter? Right? Does anybody have any? You know, because it's like stressful. You're working on something that matters and it's stressful. Yeah. Is it true?
I guess I just have to like reframe about what I'm doing. Like, try to find a way to get in the mindset of when I'm writing the contest plays, when I'm writing the plays I want to write for myself.
Right, right. And how do you get in that? Is what makes the contest plays fun? Is it because they are, for example, short? Is it, what is it? What is it?
They are shorter, but there's nothing to say that what I'm working on right now has to be long. So I guess I can tell myself, just write what I want to write or what I feel like is the length, and that has, not have to think it has to be like 3 acts or 2 acts or whatever.
That's true.
And just let it be what it is. Also, I don't know. These are fun too, because it's kind of like, usually there's like a theme or something, and it kind of focuses my brain in that area.
Right, which you can also make up for yourself.
Yeah.
It's tricky, because what you want to do is you want to become a free person. Right? So, right. Just like, I mean, I don't know, but, you know, as there's a moment in a child's life, or American children, that the parent says, it's time for you to be potty trained. You want to be free, you want to be independent, you want to be free. You want to be free. It takes effort and responsibility, right? Okay, which means you have to develop some skills, like you have to develop the skill of creating your own deadlines. That's a free woman. That's what a free artist does. She is self-motivated and self-directed. And you have to come up with your own themes. We don't need to wait for the man, the master, the one, the teacher, to tell us what to do, how to direct our thinking. We can do it on our own, okay? And plenty of, I'm sure, fine plays and works have come out of people telling people what to do, but, you know, if you're interested in seeing what the other side of the fence is like, right? You want to give that a try. And we want to be encouraging of ourselves when we're doing our thing, right? So we're not just doing something for some, we're doing our own thing, right?
Yes.
Okay, so you want to be that. And you want to develop a delight in your own work. There's a joy. I mean, we don't call them plays for nothing.
Play!
You know what I mean? It's play. And what you have to do is you have to, there's an anxiety that happens. I was talking to some students a couple weeks ago at Yale. I went up there and was talking to them. And we were talking about how if you're swimming in the water, you know, and the water's deep and you're sort of in the ocean, after a while, right? You have to learn that actually what you're there to do is dive and learn to swim underwater and delight in the complexity and difficulty of the path that you've chosen. Right?
Yeah, what you're going
to
find on there.
Oh, dive, dive. That's your job. Your job is to dive, not to flounder around on the surface, right? Right, and wait for somebody to tell you what to do. You're going to dive and delight in all the treasures you find underneath the surface of your surface. Okay? So to go there, you know, and if it's difficult, it's okay. Keep going. You know, and develop that. And that's what an artist, whatever she does, painter, director, dancer, you name, whatever, tightrope walker, brother, ballerina. We learn to develop a delight in our craft. You know, that's why we walk around with these smiles on our faces, even if the work is hard, to have this kind of like, right? Because it's simultaneously very difficult, and it sounds very enjoyable at the same time, right? Okay, so just remember, it's holding its hand out to you. Go there, you know? See, you smile, you know that place, right? Right, and we all do. We all forget about it. It's because it's difficult to hold in your mind and in your day to day, you know. how something you're doing kind of just for yourself should be, you know? But the, and I think the more time you spend on it, the more enjoyable it becomes. And then you get in the practice of delighting in this complexity. And there you are, there you're on your path. That's the path. And which doesn't mean that every once in a while you might forget. You need to have a community remind you or remind yourself or whatever.
I do a lot of like professional business, whatever, writing,
right.
Very little creative personal writing that ever goes beyond my iPhone. And so I decided to share with several people and then didn't hear back from any of them. So I didn't, not so much didn't hear back, but heard like very minimal different things. And I don't know if it was like the pool of people I chose or
yeah.
the content of what I chose or how I like, if I was too low-key about, oh, just take a look at your time, or like, I don't know, since I haven't done sharing before.
Oh, you're brave. So. You're so brave. Look at you. You wrote something, you finished it, you decided to share it with people, and you went out, you totally jumped off the building, and you're still flying. There's nothing wrong. You're just like, now you're cruising around going, okay, who am I going to share with next? Didn't get to, you know. And some people, just so you know, just like sharing your work is new to you, some people getting someone's work and needing to comment on it, that's new to them. Some people don't know, and they don't want to say the wrong thing, and they're not accustomed to it, okay? So that's a thing. Which means that the next person you pick to share your work with maybe needs to be someone who maybe does some writing of her own or his own, maybe. Maybe there's a writing group you can get in, you know, that has an active, that's part of the process of the group, like a short story writing class that meets once a week and you share like that. It's part of the class. So that's a good thing because everyone in that class will be expecting and expected to comment on your work, to give you feedback. It might not all be helpful, you know, but it's the format of the class. So maybe a formal class. And there are lots of them around town, you know? Even if, say, it's a poetry writing class and you're more of a fiction writer, you can still probably join and say, hey, this is the one, you know, check it out, like that, okay? But that's kind of a, if you're sharing with friends, yeah, maybe next time, or maybe if you have other friends you haven't yet shared with, ask them. You were gonna say something, no?
No, yeah, just, you know, it might widen the, some like
totally wider
colleagues
and hey,
other writing and other friends and things.
That's a good idea. That's a very good idea. And maybe prep them before, you know, because also some people, they might be tight for time. I mean, you know, there's many things that are going on in your life that make it difficult sometimes to give quick or generous responses to people. You know, your friends have that too. So it's definitely not the quality of what you sent them. It's just the people and how they have their own stuff to deal with, you know? Okay? So, yeah, definitely widen your pool. And, you know, I was going to say, think about sharing your work with people who really care about you. That's a good place to get going. Not necessarily your parents. No, not caring about you like that, but you know what I'm saying? But friends who care about you, and maybe friends who you can reciprocate. You know, maybe they have, like I said, they have writing that they'd like to show you, or maybe they have a band they'd like you to listen to, or they have they're learning an instrument and they'd like to play it in front of you for the first time, something like that, some people you can reciprocate, or child care, or whatever, you know. I'll sit for you for 2 hours if you want to give me some feedback on my, that works too. Yeah. Good question, but congratulations for being so brave. can do that. Do you have a cape?
Thanks.
It sounds like you do. Good job. Yes, remind me, I forgot you.
Wallace,
yes.
So I wanted to read something I wrote.
Uh-oh, is it long? Should I sit down? This is not what we do in this class, but you're really gonna read something?
Yeah.
Is it long?
No.
Okay.
It's a poem.
Yeah, and so is the Iliad, but and you said
it'd be right about now, it'd be. Give me 30 seconds.
Give me. I have a question first. Are you expecting me to give you feedback on your work?
Nope.
Okay, because I want to. You know, I don't want to be inappropriate. Okay. Go.
Upon the back of Horus arose a city of steel built by hands of immigrants in search of a new ideal. The Algonquins were the first, then the Dutch came next to shore. Peter Stuyvesant last led this scrappy band, scorning Dutch Jews and Quakers of yore. That's the first few lines.
That's lovely. What is it from?
It's from...
Did you write it?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's gorgeous.
It's a poem about New York City history written poetically. Mm-hmm. And there'll be other elements to it, but it was what I used the 20 minutes for,
yes,
was to look for the poem. And I have this beautiful journal. It's called an intensive journal. And
uh-huh.
And I couldn't find it, so I tried to scribble out what I could remember, and then I was able to locate it. But I added more,
uh-huh,
to that, to what I knew, because,
uh-huh,
you know, I didn't have what I thought I had.
Right.
So, but that's how I use my training.
That's gorgeous.
So where are you going with your poem?
I think as a poet, what I want to do is I want to write about the history of poetry in New York City.
Oh, cool.
You know, starting from pieces that were not known, that were perhaps done by the Algonquins,
mm-hmm,
and then later to just come up through the ages and talk about not only poets, but the famous poets, the most famous ones. Because there were lots that were,
mm-hmm,
there, but we don't know about them. Like, we know about Emma Lazarus.
Mm-hmm.
We know about Allen Ginsberg.
Mm-hmm.
We know about who else? I mean, it's just those who jump to mind.
Thousands.
Hmm?
Thousands.
I know, but it's like you don't. Most of those people are forgotten, but
yeah,
the ones you remember, like everybody remembers Emma Lazarus because of the poems she wrote.
Right.
But there were some, there were her contemporaries, Walt Whitman. But there are people who are writing in her day that they don't remember them,
right,
because,
right,
their poems didn't rise to prominence as hers were. So there will be people that I will miss, you know.
Uh-huh.
I'm
sure,
just,
sure.
It will not,
sure,
be exhaustive.
Sure.
But,
is it going to be performed? Is it to be performed, or is it not just, but...
Yeah, it's actually a part of a autobiographical poem.
Uh-huh.
And last time I was here, I talked about epic poetry.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
So I've taken my life and done that. And so it starts out, you know, how many years ago? 10 years ago.
Uh-huh.
And kind of starting in 1999.
Uh-huh.
And it moves through the present day, talking about the things I learned. So it will be a part of a larger piece.
Sounds good. What's the title?
Right now it's called The Fairy Chronicles. A very specialized word. There in the 1970s, there was a movement of gay men, mostly pagan, that drew a word, an ideal out of native culture called the Burdash, or the two-spirited warrior, male and female, androgynous. And now many of those people are, that movement is called the fairy movement, the radical fairies. So they're very known for educational efforts, during the beginning of the AIDS movement, the AIDS crisis, going into gay bars and letting people know about using condoms and so on and so forth. So they're like really important to the, I guess, the preservation of gay culture and gay identity. And a guy by the name of Harry Hay was like the leader, the first of that movement. So I'm one, and the thing about it is none of us are alike, right? So someone who is, they would say, you're not a radical fairy. Yes, I am, because that's what I claim.
Wallace, I would totally claim you as a radical fairy. There is no doubt about it.
One of the other qualities is very often they play with the idea of gender, you know. They're not drag queens necessarily. They're just men who say, what rule says that men can't wear a skirt as a part of everyday wardrobe?
What kind of skirt?
It depends. Sometimes they're called broom skirts.
Broom skirt?
Is it
long?
Yeah, I mean, it's like sarong.
Oh, sarong.
I mean, it's like some of the clothing, you move the men into another culture.
I was just getting you with a fashion, man. I was totally joking.
Oh, I got a fabulous skirt. Yeah. So anyway, so the fairy comes to New York.
Sounds great.
I appreciate, because I was really looking forward to this. You know, this is where I can actually talk about my creative process. So I'm very grateful for it.
Yeah.
Awesome. More, but you know, do you have a deadline so we can break the script? Do you have a deadline?
I would like to put the four pieces together for my birthday on November 11th.
Okay.
So
okay.
I have three already written, and okay. So this is the fourth.
Oh, great. Okay. And you have a good method for finding your work when you need to find it.
Yes, coming here, because otherwise it would still be, it would still be on the shelf.
Okay, so you're going to put the four together by your birthday.
Yeah, November
11, that's a good birthday.
66?
You? Oh,
in 1966. Yeah. Anybody
else?
Can I ask a question?
No. Yes, Audrey, you can ask a question.
I'm not sure if it's like totally the right forum.
We'll see.
Let me know. So I'm mainly a producer.
Yes.
But I'm interested in what like the ideal kind of producer playwright relationship is, and like this new, in sort of like a way of thinking of like a producer as like sort of a dramaturg and collaborator mm-hmm. type person, mm-hmm. and not just the person who like tracks the budget and like finds the thing.
Right.
Is there like, I guess it's not exactly a question. I guess I'm just, what is that, what would be a good version of that relationship?
What would be a good, so obviously, what would be a good version of a relationship between a playwright and a producer that's not just someone who runs the budget? I mean, because people in Audrey's department, you guys are legendary, and you can make magic happen. I mean, but it's very much magic that most people going to the theater don't even notice. We go, we sit there, and you guys have made all this beautiful stuff possible, right? Examples of people we know?
I don't know. I mean, like, what do you look for, like, in a collaborator? Like, do you look at it as a producer, as a collaborator, or do you not? Like, do you prefer somebody who's, like, more hands-off? Like, what is the...
Right. Do you know what I mean? Yeah. It depends on the producer, actually. Because some producers you want in the room and some you don't.
Huh.
Right? Right? I mean, some people you want in the room helping you get there to the finish line, and some people you really don't want their notes. Yeah. Right? So, people in the public theater you want in the room. You definitely want them in the room. So, like, you think of Oscar. You know, you want Oscar in the room because you want to hear what he's thinking. And not just because he's a big cheese with the long hair, but because he gives really good notes. So he's, I mean, in my mind, he's the kind of producer that you would want, you know, the producer who's also a dramaturg, kind of thing. Or Maria or Mandy, you want them in a room, you know? Yeah. You want to hear what they're thinking. Now, this means that you have to develop a real relationship with, say, the playwright. And that takes some effort. But it's not bad. It's like you read their play and then you say, hey, can we grab a cup of coffee because I'd love to talk with you about your play. And, you know, where are you in the writing process? And because I really like to be the kind of producer who offers when asked, you know, dramaturgical advice. And you can just start a relationship, but you have to begin it, because most playwrights, they're not going to say, hi, who in the room has notes for me? You know what I mean? You're going to have to approach them. You know.
Yeah,
that makes a lot of sense.
Yeah, sure. Just in terms of like giving, I would never want to give somebody notes who doesn't want them, and at the same time, is there like a good way to gauge whether somebody wants them or not? Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, I think if you begin the relationship before rehearsal starts, that's a great, because then the pressure is much less. So when you read the play that you like and you know it's going to be the season or whatever, then you start the relationship then, right?
Yeah.
And you can say, I'll be around. So if you want, you know, another set of eyes on it, I'd be happy to, you know, and you bet they're going to be calling you. It might not be appropriate, you know, because maybe other people in the room might be like, wait a minute, she's only going to take my notes. So it might be a little tricky. So you'll have to be kind of maybe back channel about it, you know. You know?
Yeah.
But definitely, there's plenty of, and you know, writers like people who give them notes that are helpful, so.
That makes sense.
Yeah. Good for you. Yay! Anybody else? Yes, and
Rebecca.
Hey, Rebecca. Welcome back. It's good to see you. How's it going?
All right. Spent 10 days on the second draft.
Oh, right on.
With the fantasy that I would get through. So it's a book length draft. Yeah. I get all the way through it.
Wow, well, that's a lot.
Well, but I got through enough that
good.
I'm sort of feeling a redirection.
Oh, is it good?
Well, I think the one thing that is good is I'm sort of figuring out, so this is about someone else who, and of course, it has, it's not a memoir, but it has personal stuff in it.
Uh-huh.
So getting the balance of that, I'm trying to figure out how to represent a crime that was probably a reaction to a crime.
Huh.
So that I'm struggling there, and one of my informants, the original unreliable narrator,
right,
lied to me about some historic, he's a historian, he lied to me about the availability of some historical documents. So now my struggle is with how much more research I should do.
Right.
I actually really do need to see these court documents.
You actually?
I have to see them, I think.
Right.
They're actually the transcripts of the grand jury.
Right.
Who told me they'd all been burned, taken to the dump, and they're in Nashville, state.
Wow.
I think they just finally got them, because I've been on this for 10 years.
Right,
which
right.
is the other thing. It's just like, damn, I want to be done.
Right.
So, I just feel, I think the pressing thing in terms of is getting the how to represent a crime that,
right.
that, I mean, it was murder. That
right.
one might have, I consider justified.
Right.
Not necessary and not right, but
right.
justified.
Right.
And how to represent that.
You mean how to represent it, how to write about it?
Yeah. And how to, you know, that Bob Marley song, I shot the sheriff, but I did not shoot the deputy. Well, who shot the deputy? And just this deputy was beating up a black woman.
Right.
So how to?
It's not first person. Is it third? I mean, just
well, see. It goes.
It moves around. It moves.
It moves. Yeah.
Okay. So in when you're talking about the crime, which person will it be?
It's the newspaper coverage, but it's a kind of balance between what the white paper said and the black paper said.
Right.
Which are two totally different narratives. But it doesn't feel like enough to, at this point, to let those two things sort of talk to each other. Represent different versions.
Right.
Yeah.
So are there characters who could provide that?
I made the story in character.
Okay.
But mostly because he lies all the time.
Right.
But, you know, I think it is probably. So then there's the balance between the story and the commentary.
Right.
And I think it's a commentary issue. But. It's confusing.
So you have a draft of it already that's not working? Is that?
I don't know if it's working. I'm only 55 pages in to the second draft.
But you've gone over the material before and presented it. You've shown this part of the book. I mean, you've written this part of the book already, and then you've gone on. I mean, you said it's a second draft, so I'm assuming that you have a first draft of this particular difficulty, and it's not working.
No, I don't think it is.
Okay, so what does it mean?
I started out wanting to write about the Jim Crow period without ever saying the words Jim Crow.
Right.
So that people would feel it as opposed to have some idea of it.
Right.
And that's what I want this to do.
Yeah.
Is have people feel both the action and the consequences of the action. And and not, you know, not 80 years later hold it against them. So, I know it's like, in terms of writing, it's like, there's this thing up here I'm reaching for, and it's just out of my skill and range and reach.
Why do you say that?
Well, because that's the best way to write.
No, just out of my skill and range.
The structure. You know, I feel like there's certain things we all know how to do, and there's certain things we learn how to do in the process of trying to reach that perfection. I'm not going for absolute perfection, but I am going for I'm not sure there's. I mean, I need to keep writing in. I know that.
Yeah, but it's okay to have to realize, you know, you're in the difficulty of it, and that's okay. And that's okay, you're realizing that it's going to take some growing as a writer to get there. And that's okay too. And you know, like you said, it's a new skill that you are acquiring, you know, and it gets closer and it gets more reachable as you continue to work on it, you know. It seems like you're going to get there. You just need to keep walking. And it's difficult. You worked on it for 10 years.
Well, a lot of that was just piecing stuff together.
Sure.
8 years of it was just piecing it together. So this is the moment where I feel like I have most of it.
Uh-huh. have another block of time to work on it?
I'm trying to figure that out. Probably after I teach still some, so probably after graduation. It could take a couple of weeks.
It's very exciting. Well, keep going though. Good luck with it. Sounds like it's a great project.
I've got one from online.
There's
a couple of paragraphs, but I'll choose a part of it. This person, Janine Robinson, is saying that she feels like she's in a gather phase for a project and not sure what the piece is. She wants to make herself sit down and work, and it's just not coming. Any suggestions? And do you use a typewriter in real life?
Real life. As opposed to what we were just doing now. So, yes, I use a typewriter in real life. I use a lot of things, you know, typewriter, write on my phone. Someone said, you know, do a lot of writing on our phone. Longhand, shorthand, computer, you know. So, yes, all kinds of things are helpful. I've written many things just writing this show. But you're in a gathering phase. She's in a gathering phase and she wants to sit down and write, and it's not happening. Maybe there's more gathering than you do, certainly. Maybe there's more gathering. But I will say also, if you feel like you're done gathering, for the moment anyway, you can just sit down with your timer 20 minutes a day and just, you know, free write and see what happens, you know? Because a lot of times you might have an idea of what it is that you're looking for, like, it's going to look like this, it's going to be a whatever, red rubber ball. And you're sitting down and waiting for the red rubber ball to descend from the ceiling. It's not happening, so you think nothing's happening. But something, in fact, is happening. And you have to just sit down and write longhand, typewriter, computer, whatever. 20 minutes a day, just start talking to yourself. You know, mulling over your gathered things. And things will start to piece themselves together, like Rebecca was saying, piecing the things together, right? Things start to collect together for you. That's what I do. I hope that's helpful. That time I keep...
That's like 30 seconds or so.
30 seconds. Anybody okay? There's excitement in the lobby today, I tell you. Okay, so are we back next week? Can everyone?
We're back on April 30th.
We're back on April 30th. April 30th, 5 p.m. We will be doing another installment of Watch Me Work. All right, so it's going.